Our Father, we thank you that we have just a chance to come together in great numbers and discuss so many issues of importance to our church and to our church in the world today. This particular subject is one in which we probably should pray for 58 minutes and talk for two, rather than the other way around, Lord. But we ask that you would help us to be wiser about this great subject of renewal and revival because we spent this time together. And we pray that there would be fruit in our lives and in our church's lives because of this time together. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, what I need to know, and I know this is kind of, there was no way for me to do this before I got here, but obviously I have, on this subject, our biblical theology of revival. I've spoken before. There are things around on the internet, papers and things that are out there. I don't even know quite what's out there. I have written a book called Center Church, and I devoted a section in Center Church to the subject of revival, biblical revival. So I'd like to know, just raise your hand if you've already gotten what you would consider exposure to what I have said about revival. You've heard something or you've read something before by me on this subject. Raise your hand. Thanks. Put them down. That's completely unhelpful. Thank you very much. It gives me no guidance at all. Excuse me, I'm going to flip a coin here. actually, it sounds like I need to probably... Here's what I would like to do. I would like to give you a survey of the subject. I can just tell you that in the Book Center Church, I have most of the material that I have assembled in my own mind and I've taught on. So what I'm giving you here, generally speaking, is an overview of that material. But because there is a relatively significant number of you who've already been exposed to much of this, I'm going to, in spite of our size here, I'm going to take questions. So we have a mic here and we have a mic there. We have three. So I really do want to take questions. So to make sure that, especially those of you who have heard this and would like me to elaborate perhaps more, can get me to say some, ask me specific questions and perhaps get some things out that I don't have written down somewhere else or you haven't heard before. Let me start with a personal introduction. When I became a Christian in college, in InterVarsity, on a Northeastern Liberal Arts University campus, Bucknell University, quite a good long time ago, 1970, I was part of a small InterVarsity fellowship group. That group perhaps had anywhere from 5 to 15 people coming at various times in the first 2 years that I was involved with it, my freshman year, my sophomore year. Suddenly, my junior year and my senior year, the numbers of people that went to the InterVarsity Fellowship went up about times 10. Suddenly, we had 100, 150 people coming, a lot of people becoming Christians. And we remember, I remember very clearly that InterVarsity used to have a Central Pennsylvania conference in which students from the various chapters on the various Central Pennsylvania college campuses would come together to have a conference in the spring. And generally, since most of the chapters had 10 to 15 students in them, maybe 3 to 5 students would come to the conference, and there might have been 10 schools, and so, you know, you'd have 30, 40, 50 students, and it was fun. It seemed like a lot of people. Suddenly, the same year, though there was no particular coordination at all, and this is back, honestly, and it's hard for some of you to understand. This is before not just cell phones. This is not just before social media. This is before answering machines. Just okay. You know, this is like, you know, we'd just gotten past etching, you know, writing letters by etching, you know, characters into the clay and sending them along. So there was really no coordination. And I remember that in my junior year, of course, there were all these new Christians, and our conference, our campus chapter had grown so large. We went to the conference, and it was enormous because the same thing had been happening all over central Pennsylvania. In fact, during the year of 1970, it happened on college campuses, both Christian and non-Christian campuses all across the country. I didn't know what to make of it. It wasn't a concerted effort. It wasn't a, there was no campaign. There wasn't any media. we didn't use the word movement hardly at all. There was no command and control, top-down coordination. There were no committees. There was nothing. What happened? I do remember that I graduated from college, and I decided I wanted to go into the ministry. I went to Gordon Conwell Seminary, and in fall of 1972, Richard Lovelace was teaching for the very, very first time. He was a church historian there, a course called The Dynamics of Spiritual Life. It's the first time he'd ever taught it. And what he wanted to do was he wanted to distill out his historical research on revivals. He had been a historian of revivals. He studied the awakenings. And he wanted to distill it all down, and he had a course called Dynamics of Spiritual Life in which he brought that together. And I took that course, I remember in the fall of 1972, and I was stunned because it was, to a great degree, describing what I had just seen on my college campus. Then I went into ministry, age 24, took a church in Virginia, a Presbyterian church, PCA church, and was there for 9 years. I went off to Westminster Seminary, taught there for 5 years. All during that time, always took a kind of interest in revival. I talked about revival. I taught about it. Went to New York City to plant Redeemer Presbyterian Church in 1989. And between, I'd say, about 5 or 6 months after we got there, from early 1990, probably till late 1991, it happened again. At least I saw much of the same dynamics in that situation that I had seen back in college. It felt the same. It smelled the same. And we grew in the middle of Manhattan, in a very a city where people were moving out because of the crime. It's a very, very different place than it is now. It was not the place that Christians came. We did not have church shoppers. We were starting from scratch. It was a very, very difficult spot to start. And yet the church grew to about 1,000 people coming in about 2 years. I'm a better preacher now than I was then. It's not like, oh, he was a good preacher. You know, I hope I was a good preacher. But it wasn't, it's not like that. And we certainly weren't that organized. Certainly didn't have a great staff. Didn't really have a staff, or hardly. What's going on here? It's what I think has been historically called revival. There are different definitions of revival. I'll give you two. One is what I'll call the frontier definition of revival. Revival in this definition is a season of extremely vigorous evangelistic exertion. And of course, when I remember very clearly, I was not from the South. I was a Northeastern kid, a Yankee. And when I moved to the South back in the 1970s, I was surprised, actually. I was also a relatively new Christian, even though I was, you know, in the age 24, I was the pastor of a church. Age 20, I really wasn't a Christian, so out of about 4 years. So I wasn't really all that. I did not have an evangelical background at all. By the way, I came up in a mainline Lutheran background. So it was a little surprising to come south and see, especially after taking the course with Richard Lovelace, to see churches say, revival, April 21st to April 27th. I said, you're kidding. How could they do that? And how do they know it's going to happen from April 21st to April 27th? And what's wrong with April 28th? And of course, this was the frontier tradition, was the tradition of Charles Finney. It was the tradition of revivalism. It was the tradition that revival was was something that human beings really can do if you work very, very hard. And the emphasis is on the meetings and the way of preaching and the music and the emotion. I'm not trying to be too negative here, but I'm trying to say the frontier approach was revival is a season of evangelistic exertion. A second approach to revival probably could be called the Pentecostal approach. And the Pentecostal charismatic approach to revival, that they probably are now the part of the worldwide church that talks about revival the most. And in their, I think, understanding, revival means just generally church growth, certainly, but it also means the coming of the extraordinary gifts of the Holy Spirit. It means tongues, and it means healing, and it means miracles, and so it's it's centered around the extraordinary gifts of the Holy Spirit. The definition that I got from reading history, and as I'm going to try to show you, a definition I got from reading the Bible too, and from my own experiences of it, is this: that revival, biblical revival, is not just something that human beings do. It's not mainly the extraordinary operations of the Holy Spirit. Real revival is the intensification of the ordinary operations of the Holy Spirit. And those ordinary operations are conviction of sin, conversion, converting, the giving of assurance, and sanctifying, making us holy. And when the Holy Spirit, those operations are intensified across a church, maybe even a small part of a church, across a denomination, across a city, across a country, you've got revival. And the revival consists of these three things. Now, I'm running through an outline that you can find fleshed out in the book Center Church. When revivals happen, you see three things happen. Sleepy Christians wake up, nominal Christians get converted, and hard-to-reach, conscious non-Christians get dramatically brought to faith and brought into the church. You hear that? Sleepy Christians get awakened. Nominal Christians who are in the church get converted. They realize they're not Christians. They never have been Christians. And hard-to-reach cases of people who are against, you know, Christianity altogether get very often dramatically brought to faith and to come into the church. When I say sleepy Christians get woken up, it's because when the Holy Spirit begins to do His work, it brings repentance and assurance. See, one of the problems of the ordinary Christian is neither happy nor sad enough. We're not convicted enough about our sin. We're not experiencing deep repentance, and also, or maybe I should say, and therefore, we don't experience high assurance. Now, there's assurance and there's assurance, but I was always influenced by David Martin Lloyd-Jones in his sermons on Romans. When he gets to Romans 8:16, he gets to that place where it says, the Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And he tells a story. Some of you may have heard me tell this story too. He tells a story he got from Thomas Goodwin. So he got it from Thomas Goodwin, I got it from him. And now you're going to go home and use it, because you got it from me. But it's a story of a man walking down the street with his little son. Thomas Goodwin says he one day saw a man walking down the street with his son. They clearly were father and son. They clearly were affectionate. But at one point, the father picks the son up and hugs him and loves him and hugs him and kisses him and says, I love you. And he says, I love you too, Dad, or whatever they said in 17th century England. And then after that, the boy's put down. You can't live your whole life in your father's arms, and on you walk. Thomas Goodwin said, Lloyd-Jones said, ah, objectively, the father and the son were legally father and son. And when the boy was in the father's arms, he wasn't legally more of a son, but he was experiencing his father's love. He was experiencing his sonship. And so Lloyd-Jones turns and ends by saying, when it says the Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we're children of God, what it's really trying to say is your spirit, that is to say, you know you're a child of God. You believe the Bible, you believe that Jesus died for you, you put your faith in Him, and now you, your spirit, knows I'm a child of God. But it's just a kind of an abstraction. But when the Spirit bears witness with your spirit, when the Spirit comes aside and says it's true, He's bringing this assurance. The conviction of sin and the assurance of who you are in Christ, the assurance of God's love, it wakes sleepy Christians up, most of which are just really sleepwalking through life. It also, revival also converts nominal Christians. churches are filled with people who think they're Christians, they're baptized, they're members, very often they're officers. And when revival breaks out, a lot of them will come to you and they will say, I thought I was a Christian, now I know I never was. Sometimes they'll say, I had a secret life, I was doing this or that, it was awful. But very often they'll say, I realize now that actually I never really understood the gospel. I never really understood what it meant to be saved by faith. I really actually was pretty much uptight in my own works righteousness. I never understood why Christianity didn't seem to work for me the way it worked for other people. God never seemed real to me, and now I realize I've given my life to Christ. And very often this is your church treasurer. Now, I've never seen a time of renewal when some of that didn't happen. It's not your job, if you're a pastor, to look at baptized people who profess faith in Christ and say, I think you're a Christian, I don't think you're really converted. It's not your place. You can't do it. A person, by the way, who is very overtly sinning and being unrepentant, is church discipline, that's another subject. But the point is that you can very often sense that there's people that don't have the savor of Christ about them, but you can't just go through, not you. During times of revival, the Spirit goes through and does that. And then lastly, of course, there is church growth during times of revival. There are a lot of people who find faith in Christ, but partly it's because of this. When sleepy Christians wake up and nominal Christians get converted, it beautifies the church. It becomes an attractive place. It becomes a powerful place. And for various reasons. One is because very often the sleepy Christians, the nominal Christians, actually begin to reach out to their neighbors in a way they weren't doing before. But also because people who hear about it sometimes it spreads around and what's going on in the churches, and people come in just because they're curious. In other cases, they come in because they're brought. But church growth also happens. And so those three things happen. And if somebody says, well, what is the, what are the marks of revival? If that's what happens, that's the definition, let me give you a couple of ideas on this. And I want to right away tell you, I'm not talking about programs, and I'm not talking even about methods. I'll get to that in a second. I'm talking about theological marks. Times of revival almost always have some version of a sense in which the gospel is recovered. And it's believed and it's communicated in a newly vital and vivid way, and it's recovered. And you say, recovered from what? Well, there's only two places to recover from. The gospel is between legalism and antinomianism. The gospel is neither legalism nor antinomianism. These are the two errors on both sides of the gospel. The gospel is not that you're saved by works. The gospel is not that once you're saved, it doesn't matter how you live. The gospel is you're saved by faith alone, but not by faith which is alone or remains alone, but issues in holiness of life. And almost always, because legalism tends to often be a kind of rigid conservatism, and because antinomianism tends to be a kind of liberalism, generally speaking, revival happens when a church gets on the gospel center, very often by moving away from that rigid conservatism or away, joyless people who are just simply anti-everything, into a more positive, gospel-centered, grace-filled Christian life. Or there's a recovery out of the liberalism that really doesn't believe in the atonement, doesn't really believe that in hell, doesn't really believe that we are sinners and that Jesus had to propitiate the wrath of God. So there's a recovery of the gospel. Second theological mark is there's a sense of repentance. This is to me one of the things that distinguishes what I would call real revival, and also what I see in history of revivals, from a kind of emotional frothiness, which often goes under the name revival. Repentance is very, it can come in such different ways, but so many of the books I've read on the revivals of the 18th century and the 19th century and so on said that in spite of the fact there was a great deal of joy, in many of the assemblies during times of revival, was a tremendous sense of awe. A lot of silence. It wasn't, revivals aren't, I don't know how to say this, the revivals I've seen aren't necessarily noisy. They're quiet because people, and what those of you who are preachers, do you not know that in some ways you know that you're preaching the gospel the best in the most incisive way when it gets more quiet in the room? And in some ways, the revivals are times in which the whole church gets quiet for several years. They're not fighting. They're not boasting. They're quiet they're humbled under the mighty hand of God. The accounts of the Korean, the early stage of the revival that led to tremendous growth in the Korean church, very, very beginning of the 20th century, the very beginning there, 1905, 1910, the great revival that happened in Pyongyang, repentance was a very, very big part of it, a very big part of it. There's one place where it said that when the revival spread in some of the towns, you know, many of the Korean towns had Chinese proprietors. Very often the Chinese were the rich people in town, and they owned the businesses. And it was fascinating. I read one account that said so many Chinese proprietors were astonished because when the revival started to spread, we had Korean Christian people who had become Christians, or Korean Christians who were sleepy Christians that woke up and came under conviction of sin, started coming back to the proprietors and confessing the fact that they had robbed them or stolen from them or shoplifted or cheated them on a deal. Repentance. Third theological mark, anointed corporate worship. You say, well, weren't you just talking about that? Well, repentance is actually still something basically that comes from, it's still more of an individual thing. Some of you know, right, that the Asbury Awakening, there was a chapel service, is it not? It also happened at Wheaton, isn't that true? That there were a couple of, during 1970 in that vicinity, there were a couple of chapel services that went like for weeks, round the clock, 24 hours, because during the chapel services, students started getting up and confessing. I'm sleeping with my boyfriend and I really want to stop and I'm confessing this to God. And there was public confession that started, and what that did was it brought about, a remarkable spiritual seriousness on the campus. But I don't think this is quite the same thing. When I say anointed worship, I mean non-Christians, everybody knows that God is there. God is there. I remember Jack Miller some years ago said when Isaiah went into, remember Isaiah chapter 6, he goes into the temple and he sees the Lord high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple, and there was the cherubim, and there was smoke filling the temple, and he fell down. He says, you know why he fell down? He went to church like most people went to church every single Sunday. The last person you expect to actually see there is God. You go to church, oh my gosh, God's really here. And actually well, 1 Corinthians 14 says that when the non-believer comes in and the secrets of his heart are revealed and he's cut to the quick and he will fall down, and what will he say? He doesn't say, oh, I'm cut to the quick. He says, God is truly here. God is truly among us. 1 Corinthians 14 talks about that sense of God's presence. And that's also very much a theological mark of revival. 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, I already said this. There's always church growth. In spite of the fact that the frontier version of revivalism is church growth, period. That's if the church is growing, we're having a revival. And I hope you see that that's not necessarily the case. But put it this way, you can have church growth without revival, but you can't have revival without some church growth. Because when God's working like that, it's just impossible for you to keep your mouth shut about the gospel with your friends. And then finally, extraordinary prayer. The last of the marks, theological marks, is prayer beyond the ordinary. Sorry, you might be a praying church and you pray in corporate worship and you pray in your small groups and you have your regular prayer meetings. Or you might have a Wednesday night prayer meeting, which I had for years in my church in Hopewell, Virginia. But extraordinary prayer means prayer beyond the ordinary. Prayer that is not just for my needs, but for the kingdom and the coming of the kingdom. Now, the last thing to say is just this. And that is, notice I didn't give you methods. I gave you theological marks. I gave you, I think, pictures that are concrete enough that you could tell revival if you see it. And you say, well, how do you get revival? Well, I would say you go after those theological marks. You preach for conviction of sin, you seek to recover the gospel, you ask God for anointed worship, you do extraordinary prayer, you evangelize, you do it. Whether God sends it to you or not is actually up to him. And I'll just tell you two other quick things. The method, see, the 18th century revival, the Great Awakening with John Wesley and George Whitfield, look carefully and you'll see there was a method. There was an electrifying method. It was outdoor preaching. Nobody had ever done it, at least not in recent memory. And it was in a kind of established church situation where you had parishes and people were, you know, it was electrifying, the outdoor preaching. It was a method. It was a way of doing something. It drew people together. It was fascinating. It was great, okay? There are other revivals in which outdoor preaching had nothing to do with it at all. The Great Awakening, well, not Great Awakening, it was not called that, but there was a revival in downtown New York. Some of you know about it from 1857, 1858, 1859. It was significant. Records are hard. It's hard to be absolutely sure, but many historians would say that back then New York City was only Manhattan. The other boroughs like Brooklyn and Queens were you know, separate. And there were 800,000 people in New York City, and in a two-year period, about 80,000 people joined the churches. So we're not just talking about decisions for Christ. At least 10% of the population of Manhattan in a couple-year period seems to have gotten converted and joined the churches. And that had nothing to do with outdoor preaching. It basically happened through noontime lay-led prayer meetings that happened all over the city every single day, and people coming in and praying and hearing the gospel there, and they were drawn into the church that way. You can't, to put it this way, somebody once said, you can never get back into Narnia the same way twice. You got through the wardrobe once, it won't happen again. Same thing is true of revival. Martin Lloyd-Jones says, I remember him saying at one point, he says, one of the sad things about Wales when he was growing up, he was a young man, there had been a tremendous revival in Wales just about 20 years earlier, before, when Lloyd-Jones was a child, there was a great revival. When he was going to the ministry 20, 30 years later, there were a lot of people who had become Christians during the Welsh revival, and he said one of the tragedies was that they were stuck in the method, that it was very difficult to get people out of the methods that had worked. And so he said there were a lot of people who felt like the Spirit only works when we're singing these songs. These are the songs that God used, and you know, and this is the orchestration, and this is the kind of meetings, and we have to do it because that's how God did it. And you get stuck. You get stuck. You mustn't get stuck. You have to be utterly creative, because every single time revivals come, they come with some new method generally that's pretty intriguing and is very effective. But there's one other thing. God has to do it. And you say, well, of course God is sovereign. God often sends some sort of upheaval in the culture. There may be a revival going on in China. To some degree, if that's the case, it's to some degree because there's cultural upheavals. The great revival that happened at the beginning of the 20th century that brought Korea from a 0% Christian country into about a 40% Christian country, to some degree happened because of big cultural upheavals where the Japanese, you know, had humiliated Korea and had conquered Korea, basically. And it was a tremendous national loss of face, and it was very, very difficult. And so very often when there's a cultural crisis that God in his providence sends, there's a the normal operations of the Holy Spirit get intensified. And so I don't want that to happen to America. I don't want that to happen to Canada. I don't want that to happen to the places where we are. But sometimes in God's providence, that might be what he does. Well, you don't pray for that. You pray for revival. You pray for revival, and you say, do whatever it takes. Do whatever it takes. So I think I'm going to stop there. It's an overview. If you ask me questions about where do you find all this in the Bible, I've got things I could say. If you ask me other questions, I could give you some ideas. And we have about 25 minutes left, and I'm going to see whether it would be better use of your time and my time if I let you decide what you want me to talk more about on this subject. So somebody go to a mic. It wouldn't be bad if you were somebody who said, I've heard all this before from you, Tim. I'd like a couple new ideas, you know, something else, and that would be a good use of your time to go to the mic. So, sure, go ahead.
Dr. Keller, this is a twofold question, but the first question isn't consequential. But have you heard or are you familiar with the small revival that happened in Canada in the 1971, 1972?
The revival that happened in Canada, and you're referring to, well, give me some of the features.
Like at Bill McLeod's church was the church that it happened to with the Cetera twins coming in. It's small, but it is.
I've heard of it. Yeah, I have heard of it. I mean, there are. Go ahead.
Okay. Anyways, I'm good friends with the Cetera twins who were there, as well as Bill McLeod, whose church it was started in, and. And as I've learned lots from them on the topic of revival, one of the questions that has, over the years of learning from them, come up in my mind is revival just another offshoot of ministry such as pro-life or creationism? And is it something that we need to be pursuing, or should our focus just be on being biblical?
Is revival a...
Is it an offshoot of ministry? Like pro-life is an offshoot of, you know, being biblical. It's a pro-life ministry, a creationism ministry. Is revival just one of those? And should our focus not be so much on seeking revival, but just teaching people in the church to just be profoundly biblical?
I'd probably put it the other way around. I would never want to say revival is an offshoot of anything. It's very, very central. Yet I've been trying to get across to you, I don't believe the frontier approach to revival, which is you can have one if you want it. You just have to do the method, and you can hold one for two weeks if you have enough meetings and you have, you know, the right preachers and so on. I would never believe that. But seeking revival, our main ministry. Now, just stay right there for 1 second. Our main ministry. I want to make sure I've got you here. Our main ministry, I think, in the church is to see conviction of sin and conversion. And you want to see people savoring Christ and enjoying Christ and becoming holy. So that's the main thing. I would say when you say, I'm pro-life and I would like to work for the, I want justice for the unborn in our society, I would consider that an offshoot because... It's a good work. That's a good work. You're justified not by your works. You're justified by faith alone, but that faith will result in good works. So I'm not going to get any really good works out of people unless they're justified by faith, unless they have the gospel, unless their lives have been changed by the gospel. So when I talk about revival, that's the core of what we're supposed to do, and the other things I would consider offshoots. Okay, let's... I'm glad we got a line. I'm going to go back and forth over here until we're done.
Hi. Thanks for this. I wanted to ask when revival, you saw revival in New York, if you wanted to just comment on what kind of specifically that looked like. And then I don't know if it's a completely different question, and it might be more relevant. What do you think the particular cultural difficulties are in our context for seeing biblical revival? So particular repentance issues that might be tough for us to go after or obstacles to, I don't know, it manifests different in every culture and every age. So I'm just wondering what you're seeing for our culture right now.
Okay. When you say in New York, you mean my early years.
Yeah.
You don't mean the Fulton Street Revival of 1857. I wasn't there. I'm old. I'm old, but I'm not that old. Yeah, okay. Well, this may sound a little bit like a cop-out, but I actually, when I went through my description, when I talked about sleepy Christians, nominal Christians, and all that, that was what I saw. First of all, we had people who came to Redeemer in those first years who had been Christians in other churches. When you start a church, you're always going to bring some people in from other churches that were evangelical. And we had some dramatic conversions, some people who said, I was raised in a Christian home, and I was the treasurer of the church I came from, and I now realize that I've been living an inconsistent life, but I didn't understand the gospel in a way. And so I had people like that. I also had a number of people who had began to experience a joy and a sense of Christ's presence that they'd never experienced. We also, the good thing about a place like New York is single people, and that's all we had at first. We still are a majority single. It's easier for single people to ask other single people to come to church than it is for a family. See, if here's a Christian family and you know a non-Christian family, you try to get that non-Christian family to church, they almost all have to want to go. If the husband wants to go, the wife doesn't, or vice versa, they're not going to go. If the parents want to come and the teenagers say no, they may not come. But the singles make unilateral decisions because they're single. And what surprised me was that when we saw some the sleepy Christians and some nominal Christians wake up, when they turned to their neighbors to start saying, to be a little more bold and more humble. See, when you have the assurance, you're bolder and humbler. You're convicted of sin, so you don't have the arrogance you had. But you also are more confident and less concerning about what you look like to other people. So a gospel-transformed character makes you automatically a better evangelist because you're both bolder and humbler. And so we just had a group of people who were transformed by the gospel, and they just started bringing people in. And it shocked me, the percentage of non-Christians I was preaching to every single week. And then when the people came, a certain percentage of them became Christians. And when you're, as you all know, when you're a brand new Christian, most of your non-Christian friends that are really, most of your friends that you're very close to are not Christian. When you're a new Christian, the people you really hang out with, you've shared your heart with, you've opened your life to, and they trust you and you trust them, a lot of them are not Christian. And so for a 2-year period after you become a Christian, you have a lot of clout and credibility with most of your friends. As long as you yourself did not just get into... See, there are churches that convert people there's churches that are not particularly gospel-centered. They have what I would call them pretty legalistic. And there are people that want structure and they want authority in their lives. So they get converted to the idea that I'll be part of a place in which everybody tells me how to live every part of my life, and they want that. So they get converted to that. I won't try to evaluate whether that's a real Christian conversion or not, but they get converted to that. When they reach out to their non-Christian friends to bring them in, they have an arrogance about them and maybe an insecurity about them that doesn't make them very, very good evangelists. But a real gospel-changed life makes you a very good evangelist, and I just saw in those first 18 months, an enormous explosion of people became Christians. They brought the non-Christians. It was simple. It was just exactly what you want. That's what happened. Your second question was, real quick.
Any particular, what are kind of some particular issues that are obstacles for repentance and revival today? That's a broad one.
But. No. Here's this. It's I don't know if it's an obstacle. The average professing evangelical, I think now, young single person is having sex outside of marriage, probably. And what they'll usually say is, well, I know it's probably wrong, and then ... onto something else. I think that's a wonderful, wonderful candidate for conviction of sin. A person like that, and I think you do have to talk about that, but you have to be extraordinarily careful because the culture wants to paint us as anti-sex. So you if you're going to talk about sex in a way that convicts people of sin there, and I think a lot of Christians, I would say there's a lot of people who, in order for them, sleepy Christians, to wake up and become really renewed, they're going to have to deal with that, with the fact they're having sex outside of marriage. So you have to teach about sex in a way that's not prudish, that shows a certain, but also not lascivious and, smarmy and, look, I'm so cool because I can crack dirty jokes. you really have to be very careful how you preach about sex in such a way that it's clear that you are not, frankly, uptight about it yourself, that you've actually got a wonderful vision of what sexuality can be, that you don't talk about it too much or too little. But then in the process, I think you can convict some people of sin. I'll just tell you one other example. A minister told me years ago about something he used to do with college students. I've tried it a couple times, but it's almost too brutal in person, but it has worked every time. That when you have some college student that comes home from college and you say to him or her, how's it going in college? And they say, well, all right. And then say, well, come on by and talk to me. So you're sitting there, you know, in the pastor's study, you know, this is usually a kid that grew up, you knew him in youth group, etc. And you say, how's it going? Well, I don't know. I'm having doubts. Well, why? Well, I took a course on religion. And, you know, they said this and that about the Bible. And I'm just, I don't know. Are you going to church there? No. Are you going to a campus ministry? No. I'm just having a lot of doubts. I'm not sure. It doesn't feel real to me. So, who are you sleeping with? And what's intriguing about that question, by the way, the minister said that almost always the person's face falls and says, look, if you're hurting your conscience, of course God's going to get less and less real to you. You're hurting your conscience. You're hurting your assurance. And in some ways, your heart is so self-justifying that it kind of wants to have doubts now. Aldous Huxley has an autobiography, basically, in which he admitted the fact that he didn't want to believe in God because he wanted to have sex with whoever he wanted to have sex with. And so I do think that's, you know, is that an area we're going to have to talk to? Yeah, of course we have to talk to it. Is it a place in which there's a lot of spiritual power draining right out the back door of our churches? Yeah, and their lives, they're not. And yet at the same time, you have to do it in such a way that, and I don't see it done very well. Usually either younger evangelical pastors want to show that I am not at all afraid to talk about sex, and they make everybody squirm, even hip people squirm, because they're trying to show how completely at ease they are talking about the subject. Don't do that. But at the same time, you've got to do it in a way that really lifts up a Christian view of sexuality that is sex, which is not a consumer good. Sex, which is a way of giving yourself away, it's a means of self-donation, and not just a way of getting fulfillment and dealing with your insecurity. And I think you can do that in a way that doesn't just say, you're just sinning against the law of God. Yes, you do have to say it's sinning against the law of God, but I think you can also humble people by just unmasking them. So it is a big area that we're going to have to talk about, or we're not going to see revival. Okay, one, two, over here. Brothers and sisters, it looks like I'm not going to get to you all, but go ahead.
Hi, Dr. Keller. Thanks for your presentation. You started with a personal example of revival in a parachurch context. So I guess the heart of my question would be, is revival primarily or only a function of the local church, you know, operating according to biblical principles, or is it something that, does that give you the question? Is it possible in the parachurch? What is it?
Well, sure, it's possible in the parachurch. Okay, let's get right to, I don't want to beat around the bush. And if you look at the First Great Awakening, you look at Wesley and Whitfield, honestly, that was a complete parachurch. The whole thing was outside the churches. The churches shut their doors. One of the reasons why they had to do outdoor preaching was the churches themselves just shut their doors. And so what they did was they preached outdoors, and then the converts they brought into what they called voluntary societies. And slowly but very surely, it renewed local churches, or in Wesley's case, started a new denomination. But some of you know, and I do treat this, I won't try to make the list of pros and cons. It's in the Center Church book. There's a critique of revivalism and revival. The critique is that it weakens the local church. And the critique is that it gives people the impression you can be converted and you can become a Christian without the local church at all. And the critique goes and says the Bible doesn't know anything about churchless Christianity, a Christianity apart from the church. When the awakenings happened in the 18th and 19th century, there was a lot of there was a lot of criticism that it weakened the place of the local church. I put a lot of that stuff in the my center church book. There's something to that. There's something to that. But eventually, the 18th century Great Awakening actually, I think, strengthened the church. It definitely did. But it took a long time. So frankly, like I said, you take a look carefully at that. We talk about, now in this country, Jonathan Edwards, it was largely a local church-based phenomenon. But in the UK, I don't think it was at first. So the short answer is yes, of course it can happen in a parachurch setting. So, here.
Yeah, I work with 7th through 12th graders. I'm a youth pastor. And
oh my gosh.
Yeah, with the, with that.
Really?
With that stuckness.
How long has this been going on?
Sometimes it feels longer. with the stuckness aspect, they are so astute with patterns. So, you know, 7th grade boy confesses a sin, and then really hot senior girl gives him a hug, and then 27th grade boys all of a sudden confess the same sin. But with moments that are meaningful to them and moments that have those marks of revival, moments where there is genuine repentance and those types of things, there are often kids that out of that stuckness try to make it happen again.
Yeah.
And do you have any guidance on how to counsel them when that moment is happening in a way that's both honest and gracious?
You're on to the right thing. So they mean try to force it? They want to get it back?
Yeah, they just want to do the same thing again with the same result.
Well, you know, I told you, Lloyd-Jones felt big parts of the Welsh church were stuck for 20 years in trying to get the feeling back. And that's the reason why I used the Narnia illustration where Lewis says, you'll probably get back into Narnia, but it won't be the same way. You have to trust God to let it happen instead of... My wife would say this to her, to whoever you're... My wife would say, don't try to be the Holy Spirit. You're underqualified for the job. And very often what you have to say to kids is it's the Holy Spirit that did it. It wasn't your idea. And you have to be very careful that now we're going to tell the Holy Spirit exactly how he has to do his work, something along those lines. But and by the way, I should say one other thing quick about this. Edwards was wonderful in his works in which he believed that revivals inevitably have a certain layer of falseness, that is, pseudo-experience, over-enthusiasm, people that get involved and they seem to go berserk with it, people who clearly want to be part of something and are forcing their own emotions. He made a pretty good case that was inevitable and that the entire revival shouldn't be discredited because of that. Some of you may know that there was a minister in Southport, New York, which is on the end of, it was actually at that time part of Connecticut, but it's actually on the end of Long Island, named James Davenport. And he sort of freaked out because he really got into this outdoor preaching. So he would go into another town and he would start to preach that the minister of the church in town was not a Christian, and he was going to burn the man's books in the public square, and he snapped. Nobody quite knows what happened. And Edwards had to spend a lot of time trying to explain that just because you have that doesn't mean the revival is bad. And there are, I think, churches that see that sort of thing, that sometimes a kid gets, or some people seem to get overstimulated, or you begin to wonder, did this person really meet Christ, or is this person just talking themselves into it? Did this person really get convicted of sin, or did this person really want the attention? And unfortunately, you're just going to have a lot of the false emotions as part of what goes on, and you as a pastor need to do your very best to discern it and try to gently talk people down sometimes, but mainly say, don't try to be the Holy Spirit. That's what my wife would say, and I think she's right. Let's go over here. 5.35 minutes left.
Do you feel the teaching of cessationalism hinders revival? And what resources, in addition to Martin Lloyd-Jones, do you suggest?
Wait, cessationism. So you mean the cessation of miracles and tongues and healing?
Yes,
and
do you feel that hinders revival, the teaching of it?
Well, I'm a moderate cessationist. That is to say, I wouldn't want to, when I say moderate, I feel like there is a pretty good amount of... I don't believe miracles are over, but I believe an awful lot of purported miracles are just purported. That's all. So sometimes cessationism goes along with a fear of experience, period. So there are things that go along with cessationism that might stop revival, but I wouldn't say cessationism by itself. Like I said, I'm about 80% a cessationist myself. I'm actually pretty skeptical about an awful lot of the claims of miracles and healing. So no, it doesn't have to. But very often, along with cessationism, comes this fear of experience, and that can kill. And Reformed people are afraid of experience. We are. We would much rather have a logical argument. And so we're for revival in general, but on the ground, we have a tendency to just squash it. Lloyd-Jones, what about Lloyd-Jones?
What resources in addition to Lloyd-Jones do you suggest? What books?
Resources in addition to Lloyd-Jones?
If there is any.
What's wrong with you, man? Oh, no, no, no. I'm actually, take a look, if you can, in the Center Church book. Most of them are older, though. I mean, he's actually the only modern writer that's written a great deal about revival. You can read Richard Lovelace, certainly. Richard Lovelace's book, Dynamics of Spiritual Life, is very helpful. Colin Hanson edited a book on revival fairly recently that came out, I think, with Crossway. The Edwards stuff was not that easy to read, but it's absolutely priceless. I'll tell you one book that you might be surprised. You find it in Banner, but I think it's still in print, maybe not. But anyway, William Sprague, Lecture on Revivals. A lot of you have never heard of that book. It's really helpful. You know why? Because there's a spectrum on revival. There's a spectrum of opinion on revival. There, on this end, there's people who feel, to some degree, you can, if you do these things, you'll get revival. It's close to a church growth model. Do this, 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 you got it. There's people on the other end, and Lloyd-Jones was on the other end of the spectrum, that says, you just pray and you wait. You don't. There's nothing else you can do. And Sprague was somewhat in the middle on ways to make yourself receptive to God for revival. Lectures on revivals. It's an old book, but it's actually surprisingly interesting, especially in the chapters on how do you counsel an inquirer, a young person seems under being awakened to faith. How do you counsel that person? And also a really good chapter on dealing with criticisms of revivals that it's anti-church. Okay, over here. We've got just a couple minutes left. Yes, sir.
You helpfully gave us the marks of recognizing true revival. I heard that, and you talked about that it's a third way between cynicism and emotionalism, so I got that. So, and you said you weren't going to give us methods, but what does strategy look like? You know, whether we're in the pulpit, private counseling, leading a Wednesday morning prayer meeting, there's the private ministry of the word, public ministry of the word. What kind of strategies should pastors have to say, yeah, I'm going to be teaching you about repentance, but I think I probably need to teach you about what revival means that you don't know it means? How do you do that stuff?
Yeah, well, see, I'm trying. So I just said I wasn't going to do that, and you came up, would you do it anyway? What's going on here? I'm a preacher, so there's a tendency for me probably to overemphasize preaching. If you asked me to write a whole book on how do you preach to bring about a revival, I could do that. The trouble is I look at the Korean revival, there were too many places in the world where God clearly did some major work, and preaching wasn't the leading edge. Preaching's always part of it, the gospel. But there were, we Reformed people love the Great Awakening because it was spearheaded by tremendous preachers who went out of doors and just faced the mob and preached people, to conviction and conversion. So I do think there's a way of preaching the gospel that brings conviction, preaching to the heart, preaching Christ, preaching grace. You know, you guys, you all must know I do that. I talk about that all the time. But I actually do know that there are churches, I think, that have spent 5 to 6 years working on extraordinary prayer, and that's the main thing they have done, and they've seen fruit in people's lives. The only other thing I would say is, you got to get, it's like an avalanche. You get a few sleepy Christians waking up, a few nominal Christians getting converted, a few really, really interesting, kind of dramatic conversions from the community, and if you're preaching the gospel in this way that I've talked about, especially in the Center Church book, and if there's a real support of extraordinary prayer, that little, those first little pebbles can turn into an avalanche. That's really kind of the way it works. Beyond that, I'm scared of talking about methods. But unfortunately, I got this 0.00. And that means No. It means I got to pray and let you go. I'm sorry. Have a seat and just bow your head with me for just a second. Our Father, I really am convicted that talking about revival is, it's inspiring. It maybe produces a little bit of guilt, a little bit of longing. Please use that. I certainly have not given you much to work with, Lord, but you are the great God, and you may plant some seeds of interest, of hope. Some people read something, some people come under the conviction of the Spirit, and that revival is sought in our churches, and maybe, oh Lord, we need a lot of things in this country, in North America, we need a lot of things, but one of the things we need is revival. We thank you for the signs of revival we've seen over the last 30 or 40 years in various places in this country and some great places in other parts of the world. We ask that you would come down and that you would come down, that you would descend like at Pentecost, like in Acts 4, when the place they were praying and the place was shaken, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. And we want that, that boldness, that humility, that we want to be shaken so that we become vehicles for revival. So thank you for giving us this time in which we could talk about these things, and I pray that you would use it. And now, Lord, please bless the food that we're about to eat and bless the interaction and conversations around that food, which is one of the best ways for us to grow in grace. Stir us up to love and good works, we pray, with each other's fellowship and love. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.